Welcome to a little bit of the future that could be. Everything is achievable through technology. Better living, robust health, and for the first time in Tampa's history, the potential to connect communities in ways that no other system has ever done before.
Good afternoon. My name is Will Clark. I've lived here in Tampa Bay all of my life, and being born and raised here has taught me very well about two things. The challenges and hardships of being car-free in Hillsborough County, and of course, Disney World. Now the purpose of this film is to tell you my visions for the future of Tampa Bay. But before I go into any details, I'd like to provide you with a little clip about Tampa Bay in Hillsborough County.
Here in Hillsborough County, we have a lot going for us. The weather, the beaches, incredible people, sports from Little League to Major League. We're also home to some of the finest tourist attractions in all America and to some of the bravest men and women in the world. We've kind of gotten used to being among the best in a lot of things. But when it comes to transportation, Hillsborough County is last for commuters, dead last. And this is what dead last looks like. Dead last is a mother stuck in bumper-to-bumper traffic on I-275 trying to get her kids to school. Dead last is a nurse waiting 20 minutes at a bus stop for a bus that's still 20 minutes away. Dead last is a biker taking a chance every time he presses the pedal. Or a pedestrian just trying to get across the street safely. And dead last is a first responder who must maneuver through traffic in time to save a life.
Frustrating.
It's sad.
It's just a nightmare.
And yet as other cities, Charlotte, Denver, St. Louis, and others have moved forward and invested in major transit systems, here in Hillsborough we've been left behind and fallen to dead last. We haven't taken one major step after 25 years of talking about it.
I don't believe there's a challenge anywhere that's more important to people everywhere than finding solutions to the problems of our cities. But where do we begin? How do we start answering this great challenge? Well, I'm convinced we must start with a public need, and as we just discovered, Tampa Bay is in dire need of a new transportation system. Although Tampa would certainly benefit from any improvement, I feel we can use our current disadvantage to our advantage. We are, in essence, working from a clean slate, thanks to the brilliant innovation devised by the same man who started with nothing but a mouse.
In the early 1960s, Walt Disney was both a successful businessman and devoted family man. Watching his grandchildren grow up, Walt began to worry about the world of the future they would inhabit. he began to notice that the modern cities were hectic, disorganized, dirty, and riddled with crime. This was a far cry from Disney's clean and controlled Disneyland Park in California. Walt began to realize that all that he and his Imagineers had learned about planning buildings and space in the development of Disneyland could be put to use in planning communities, even whole cities. Disney began to engross himself in books about city planning, and all that was needed to pull something off of that magnitude. Walt Disney determined that Florida provided the ideal place to set up his new East Coast venue. However, Walt did not want to repeat himself by building another Disneyland. He wanted to create something entirely different. A community for people not just to play in, but to live in. This was the beginning of what would become known as Epcot. On October 27, 1966, less than 2 months before his death, Walt Disney made a 25-minute film about his plans for the Florida project, called Project X, and later known as Disney World. The film revealed much about Disney World and went into great detail about Epcot's design. Walt devised a way to make full use of the Florida property, with Epcot as its central attraction. The Epcot city was based on a very innovative but simple layout, the radial concept. Based on a concept similar to the layout of Disneyland Park, the city radiates out like a wheel from a central core. The city would be connected to the other points in Disney World with a main line of transportation, the monorail. Internal transportation would be provided by a whole new Disney transportation concept.
The Wedway People Mover. The first People Mover installation is already in daily operation at Disneyland. On peak days, it carries nearly 40,000 passengers. The cars you see here are approximately 5/8 scale, considerably smaller than full-size passenger cars would be for city use. Epcot's People Mover is a silent, all-electric system that never stops running. These cars continue to move even while passengers are disembarking or stepping aboard. Power is supplied from a series of motors embedded in the track, completely independent of the cars. No single car can ever break down and cause a rush hour traffic jam in Epcot. Because the cars run continuously, there will be no waiting in stations for a Wedway People Mover. The next car is always ready.
The two systems, monorail and People Mover, would come together at the Epcot Transportation Lobby. The streets for cars would be kept separate from the main pedestrian areas. The main roads for both cars and supply trucks would travel underneath the city core, eliminating the risk of pedestrian accidents. Because of these two modes of transportation, residents of Epcot would not need cars. Walt Disney died on December 15, 1966. Even as he was dying from lung cancer, his brother Roy stated that Walt was still excitedly planning in the hospital, using the ceiling tiles to imagine his city. After Walt's death, Disney directors decided that it was too risky to venture into city planning, now that its biggest advocate was gone. Roy persisted and took control of the project, stepping out of retirement to do so. However, he could not convince the board to continue with the Epcot project. The radial design and Epcot's innovative transportation system would seemingly die with the man who made Mickey Mouse.
As we now approach the 50th year anniversary of Walt Disney's experimental prototype Community of Tomorrow, it is my great honor to introduce you to my redesign of Walt Disney's radial concept, as well as what I'm calling the experimental prototype Transportation of Tomorrow, or EPTOT.
EPTOT follows the same philosophies and ideas of Epcot. It will be a system of tomorrow that will never be completed, but will always be introducing, testing, and demonstrating new materials and new systems. It will never cease to be a living blueprint of the future.
The sketches and plans you will see today are simply a starting point, my first amalgamation of ideas made presentable. Everything may change time and time again as we move ahead, but this basic philosophy of what I'm planning is going to remain very much as it is now. I don't presume to know all of the answers. In fact, I'm counting on the cooperation of American industry, community feedback, and the public government to provide their very best during the planning and creation of the experimental prototype transportation of tomorrow. By now, I'm sure you're wondering how EPTOT will move people around Tampa and its sister cities. So in the next few minutes, I'll go into detail about some of my preliminary ideas and visions for our city of tomorrow. Remember, though, as I said, this is just the beginning. And with that thought in mind, let's have a look.
EPTOT's basic structures and layouts will be based on Disney's original idea of utilizing the Wedway people movers and monorail systems in a centralized hub. However, for the radial plan, I've redesigned the wheel, so to speak. Disney's original design built EPCOT on an old wagon-style wheel, with the spokes all running linearly from the hub to the rim on the city, never crossing nor interlacing with each other in any way. EPTOT's layout is less like the radial wheel of a wagon or car, and more like that of a bicycle wheel, with tangential spokes constantly interlacing and meeting up with one another to better aid travelers in reaching more destinations faster. Each time two or more lines connect, a station is built to allow travelers to transfer between lines, meaning that people will not have to travel the entire length of one spoke to the hub to get to their destination. As for the actual transit systems themselves, both monorail and people mover will work off of the same track, with the Wedway using the top part of the track, and the monorail suspending itself from below. Between the two Wedway tracks would be what I'm calling the Wedway Skyway, a special above-ground walkway allowing bicycles and pedestrians to travel the Wedway route under covered protection from both the weather and automobiles. The Skyway would also feature a moving walkway going in both directions, giving pedestrians yet another option in getting around Tampa Bay. The Wedway, being designed for more localized usage, would only operate within the wheel of the city. The faster and more efficient monorails would extend out from the wheel, collecting passengers from locations such as North Tampa, Plant City, Brandon and Riverview, Ruskin, Davis Island, South Tampa, and Pinellas County, as well as routes serving our serving men and women in uniform at MacDill Air Force Base, and connecting travelers from three separate airports, Tampa Executive, Heathrow Knight, and Tampa International. Also, should Disney choose to fund EPTOT in its interests, a monorail system could be connected near Interstate 4 to transfer both tourists and residents to the happiest place on Earth. Throughout Hillsborough County, monorail stations would be either constructed or integrated into already existing locations. Station architecture can be easily designed to match the surrounding environment. For example, the Sydney Monorail City Center station, pictured here, is hidden inside a downtown shopping center. The monorail adaptability provides unlimited possibilities for station locations. Stations can be built into any architectural style to blend in with the area. Like the Sydney station, this picture is a proposed monorail station at University Mall, retrofitted into an available outlot currently going unused. The monorail could serve a multitude of locations from University Mall, including University of South Florida, Busch Gardens, Adventure Island, the Museum of Science and Industry, as well as countless residential areas. Just this one example could provide a drastically beneficial change for Tampa, but as I said before, EPTOT never stops growing. After EPTOT is constructed in Tampa Bay, neighboring cities could adapt and adopt their own EPTOTs to suit their own community's needs. Locations in the illustrated example include Pinellas Park, Clearwater, West Chase, Temple Terrace, Brandon, Riverview, and Sun City Center. As EPTOTs across Florida are developed, monorail lines could connect EPTOTs together, strengthening both the bonds of the railways and the communities that house them. The connecting monorails, however, would only be the start of a much greater inner-city system. From the Wedway hub, each city's monorail lines would overlap and intersect onto the monorail Webway, named for its resemblance to a spider's web. Much like the interlacing Wedway in the city, The Webway would provide stations at each intersection, allowing passengers greater versatility in getting to their destinations. But how is EPTOT the best choice for Tampa? And why should we choose it over just a simple light rail or rapid bus transit system? EPTOT is the best choice because it best satisfies the five E's of Tampa Bay: efficiency, economy, ecology, employment, and enjoyment. Boasting a 99.8% operational readiness rating at Walt Disney World, the Wedway offers high reliability with practically no complication. The Wedway pods feature a bare minimum of moving parts, which keeps maintenance at a minimum, while vehicle weight is kept down by embedding the system's electromagnetic motors in the track, allowing the pods to continue operating even if a single engine fails. Meanwhile, monorails regularly operate at an amazing 99.9% reliability. The Express Commuter monorails operate at 2 1/2 minute intervals, traveling at 60 to 80 miles per hour, and can smoothly and reliably transport 3,000 to 50,000 passengers per hour per rail. In general, monorail infrastructure uses much less material than railway roadbeds or highway construction. The lighter weight vehicles require much less massive infrastructure, greatly reducing the use of construction materials and natural resources. Inherently more resilient and subject to less destructive loads and forces, this new infrastructure can be anticipated to last over 100 years without major replacement. Look at the difference in the lifespan between a railway and a car. It becomes incredibly pertinent to understand the lifespan of a transportation system when discussing the EPTOT investment. Among the major transport assets, the automobile is noted as having the shortest lifespan, in the range of 8 to 10 years depending on the level of usage and the operating environment. Meanwhile, rail lines, including those such as the Wedway and monorail lines, can last for decades, if not a century and a half, with proper maintenance. A typical commuter in Tampa spends an additional 47 hours each year in traffic, and spends an estimated $928 in congestion-related costs. And our region is growing rapidly. The 8 counties of Tampa Bay are expected to add more than 1.3 million new residents in the next 15 years, a population increase of over 34%. This dramatic growth will place additional stress on an already failing road system. In order for our residents, visitors, and goods to move efficiently and effectively throughout our community in the future, we need to find a way to ease this pressure. Investing in EPTOT will provide a reliable alternative to congested roadways, helping us accommodate this future growth. Americans living in areas served by public transportation save 646 million hours in travel time and 398 million gallons of fuel annually. These savings don't just apply to transit users. A study of 6 cities found that motorists with the same destinations as transit riders saved a total of over 21,000 hours daily, thanks to reduced congestion. In the most highly populated areas of our region, widening roads is no longer a feasible option to address our transportation needs. Just to widen a 4-mile stretch of Interstate 275, it costs $696 million. Not only is this incredibly expensive, but the community impacts can be devastating. In these dense areas, large numbers of expensive properties must be purchased, and in many cases demolished, to make room for additional lanes. More importantly, widening roads does little to address congestion while negatively affecting our quality of life. Adding lane after lane hasn't reduced congestion, and at some point you have to ask, where does it stop? 12 lanes? 16? Or until Tampa Bay is nothing but a giant highway? EPTOT would essentially eliminate congestion by serving over 10 times the passenger limit the cars can provide, as well as opening up the roadways already constructed to directly address our mobility needs without having to demolish or destroy properties in Tampa. EPTOT is major innovation without major renovation. In spite of seatbelts and airbags, about 40,000 people a year are killed by cars. Automobile travel is one of Florida's most expensive public health issues. Traffic accidents are the leading cause of fatalities and emergency health costs among many groups of Floridians. Ground-based mass transit is statistically about 150 times safer than travel by automobile. 95% of all transport fatalities concern roads. Less than 5% involve rail. By providing two separate rail systems and an above-ground walkway between stations, EPTOT isn't just efficient and long-lasting, it's healthy and safe. The environmental downsides of the petroleum-powered automobile are well known, and include carbon emissions and dependence on oil. Pollution from cars is estimated to kill 30,000 Americans a year. Public transportation in the U.S. saves 37 million metric tons of carbon dioxide annually already. When one individual switches a 20-mile round-trip commute to public transportation, their annual CO2 emissions will decrease by 4,800 pounds per year. The typical public transit rider consumes on average one half of the oil consumed by an automobile rider. Both monorails and the Wedway system tout a zero-emission drive system that is environmentally friendly. In 2007, the Las Vegas monorail aided in the annual removal of an estimated 3.2 million vehicle miles from southern Nevada's major roadways and reduced emissions by more than 58 tons of carbon monoxide, volatile organic compounds, and nitrogen oxides over the course of the year. By encouraging both residents and tourists to use these more environment-friendly transit alternatives, EPTOT helps reduce air pollution, water pollution, and greenhouse gas emissions, giving Florida a cleaner, more beautiful tomorrow. While transit in general has many economic benefits, rail transit in particular holds the real economic power because of its capacity to attract private investment. The areas around transit stations are in high demand for a number of reasons. Corporations prefer these locations to provide easy and reliable access for their employees. Retail establishments can take advantage of increased foot traffic from transit riders. Many residents desire to live in close proximity to a station in order to easily commute to work or school and access to other amenities. All of these factors combine to create new investment along the rail line. Across the nation, for every $1 spent on public transportation, $4 to $6 of private money are invested along the line, leading to huge economic returns. In our state of Florida, the Department of Transportation has stated that for every dollar, $5.60 are created in economic and use benefits. Examples of this success include Charlotte, North Carolina, which experienced more than $3 billion in investments, or Phoenix, Arizona, that experienced $7.4 billion of development along their line since 2001. Rail systems across the nation are thriving, and they do not have the tourist pull that Disney World, the world's most visited entertainment resort, could bring in for EPTOT. Investing in EPTOT would create tens of thousands of jobs. The American Public Transportation Association estimates that for every $1 billion invested in public transportation, 36,000 jobs are created. According to a study at the University of Massachusetts Amherst, public transportation spending creates more jobs than spending on education, healthcare, defense, and even tax cuts. These jobs would be an incredible shot in the arm for our nation's economy. The results of construction would also bring in jobs for operation, maintenance, and customer services. Furthermore, the stops and stations would bring in businesses looking to get customers that are getting off and coming on. Those businesses would also need employees. As businesses large and small look across the country for places to move or grow, they are placing an increasing amount of emphasis on infrastructure, transportation in particular. Public transportation allows employers to reach a broader base of potential employees and provide safe and reliable access to jobs. Innovative young professionals who go on to create jobs and start new businesses are flocking to transit-friendly communities. Tampa Bay is losing out on both employers and employees by continuing to focus on roads alone to address our transportation needs. What's more, the problem of job access exacerbates the problem of unemployment. Oftentimes, there are unemployed individuals who want to work, and there are jobs available that they are capable of doing. However, without the ability to get to these jobs, people are forced to remain unemployed. High-quality public transportation addresses this issue by providing affordable, reliable job access. For example, when the Minneapolis-Hiawatha line to the southern suburbs and other transit networks were upgraded, the number of low-wage jobs accessible by 30 minutes of transit travel in morning peak hours increased by 14,000 jobs. EPTOT would provide everyone with an opportunity to get to work regardless of age, income, or disability. With EPTOT, we can proudly show that Tampa Bay is ready and willing to get to work. Perhaps the most obvious benefit of EPTOT is improved mobility. Transit connects the places we live, work, and play. It provides reliable options and makes it easier to get around. Mobility is also about equity. In an auto-dominated system, true mobility is only possible for those who are able to afford and operate an automobile. This excludes huge numbers of people, the very young, the very old, the disabled, and those who are low income. EPTOT would not only include those demographics, but better serve them than any current transit system. Wheelchairs and bicycles are easily accommodated without inconvenient lifts or crowded racks due to the fact that the monorail and wedway floors are the same level with the station floor. EPTOT would help both older and younger passengers remain independent and supply access and mobility from their community into the heart of Tampa and beyond. As mentioned before, a community invested in public transportation saves over 20,000 combined hours of time daily due to the reduced commute time. Freeing up this time and easing congestion reduces stress and allows for more time to spend at home with family, enjoying the arts and entertainment of your community, or engaging in any activity besides driving, a benefit applying to riders and non-riders alike. By every measure, EPTOT makes the most efficient use of materials, resources, energy, technology, and passengers' time. In short, EPTOT is the best choice for Tampa Bay. And now, making a special guest appearance from the great beyond, Mr. Walt Disney.
That's the starting point for our experimental prototype community of tomorrow. And now, where do we go from these preliminary plans and sketches? Well, a project like this is so vast in scope that no one company alone can make it a reality. But if we can bring together the technical know-how of American industry and the creative imagination of the Disney organization, I'm confident we can create right here in Disney World a showcase to the world of the American free enterprise system. I believe we can build a community that more people will talk about and come to look at than any other area in the world. And with your cooperation, I'm sure this experimental prototype community of tomorrow can influence the future of city living for generations to come. It's an exciting challenge, a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for everyone who participates. Speaking for myself and the entire Disney organization, we're ready to go right now.
It's been almost 46 years since Walt Disney made that speech. And though the world may have changed in those 46 years, the challenge to finding solutions to the problems of our cities has not. Walt Disney felt that the answer to that challenge was starting from scratch, not just curing the old ills of old cities. With EPTOT, I believe that we can do both. The public need will be satiated, and in the process, we can build a whole new community of tomorrow. A community built with the current city, not on it. A community for our children, tomorrow's children, and the children beyond. A community that will influence the future of city living for generations to come. It's an exciting challenge, the most exciting challenge we've ever been given. Mr. Disney, it may have taken us 50 years, but I think that we're finally ready to.